So this morning we're going to have our last message on this series, God's expiry date. And the first message we explore the situation of things that we do for God, even our own life, and we have an expiry date in many things we do and many things in life. Last week we saw another aspect of things. It's that even when things are beyond the expiration date, God can extend it. And we learned about the story of Sarah, how she was already so old, and her husband, 100 years old, and beyond the expiration date, they were able to bear a child. Yeah. That was awesome. And this morning, we're going to just answer the question, has God passed the expiration date? Because we have so many people today that think we don't need God anymore. That God is something of the past, and we don't need God in society, we don't need God in school, we don't need God in government, we don't need God, period. So we're going to explore briefly about this question, and I'm sure you have colleagues and friends, and maybe you even here, you think, well, is God still present? Did he pass the expiration date? Well, I'd like to start with a Bible verse in Philippians chapter 3. Verses 14 to 15, and the Word of God says, "Press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you." God will reveal that also to you. Now, I want to give you an example. A visual example of something that happens during our lifetime. I'm going to ask, since Pastor Jordan is already here, I'm going to ask Pastor Jordan to come here. And I have something here, which is a measuring tape. And today, this measuring tape, it's going to be our life. Okay? So, if you hold here, now you're being born. And guess what? Now you're 10 years old. And your life continues, and 20, 30, don't go back, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years old, 110, 100, well, let's put it here on 90, 100, no more, is it okay, 100, okay, so let's say this day represents our life. And in our lifetime, we go through a series of events. There's a timeline, and we cannot go back. It continues further. And it gets to a point, it's just like a measuring tape. Gets to a point, there's nothing more on the inside. So let me come here to the limit of the measuring tape. And so I cannot go anymore. So I'm at the end of the tape. And one day, your life will be at the end too. And guess what's going to happen? Can you just listen to that? Your life will, thank you, your life will roll back into the inside, like a measuring tape. And just before you die, you'll be able to see some flashes of what happened. And you're asking me, how do you know that? Because I've been there. I've been there. I had two situations in my life in which this happened. It's when you're losing your life and suddenly you see a quick replay in the movie of particular events of your life. And you know, it's over. In that moment, you know, you have no more chance of changing things. Whatever you did, whatever you said, it's going to roll before your eyes, just like this measuring tape. And you'll understand something. You'll understand how small you are. You'll understand that whatever you did now, you need to be accountable to someone far greater than you. And this is your God. And many people live through life rejecting God, denying God, saying that God is for the weak, it's for the old people. It's for the Middle Ages. We don't need God now. We're in an advanced society. Now we just trust in science. There's nothing else. Guess what? Even if you don't believe in God, you have this experience where your life will roll over and you'll understand how small you are and the greatness that is beyond our life here on earth. So some of us have the privilege of having these things revealed while we're still alive, while we're still here. And you're blessed because all of you, if not most, or most of you, will have this understanding that God is real and one day we'll be before Him. But some people go through life without this understanding. They have no revelation of who God is. Now, when we start coming to church and we give our lives to God and we decide to live in the godly way, everything changes. And there's a very important thing that happens. You start growing spiritually. Remember, I talked today about connect, grow, and serve. And it's when we start growing that we go from a state of babies in God, in Christ, and we go to teenagers in Christ, and then we go to maturity in Christ. And when you reach this stage, mature in God, guess what? God will reveal that also to you. God will reveal things to you as long as you reach a state of spiritual maturity. I know that certain people come to church, you know, because they think it's a duty. For us, it's not a duty. We're in love with God. We love Him so much that we can eat all the wafers from the communion table. We love Him so much that we can just express that love with singing and with joy and clapping our hands and dancing when we bring the offering and doing all sorts of things that people think are crazy. But we're crazily in love with God.
Amen.
When we're in love with God, then we reach that level in which God will reveal Himself to us and things will make sense. I told you I went through this experience twice. And the first time I had the near-death experience, I realized that I needed to change life. I needed to change the path of my life. Because I wasn't ready, I wasn't prepared to pass away. And God gave me this opportunity. So I said, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. I will serve you. I'll do anything that you tell me. If you want me, I didn't want to be a pastor. Then he called me to be a pastor. I said, yes, I'll be a pastor. And then he moved me to different places. And I went to live in a small town. And I went to live in a farm environment. And then I went to Sweden, to a cold environment. And I went to many places in Africa and South America. I came to Canada because I know that God established a plan for my life. And I tried to follow that plan. And this is the understanding we need to have of God, that God will reveal Himself to us. Now there are some people that don't believe in God. They will still have that revelation of God, but they will not have the privilege of going through life, being prepared to that moment in which we'll finally meet our Creator, which will finally pass away from this life to a better stage of our existence. And that's what makes Christians the happiest people on earth, makes us people of faith that see the invisible, that trust in the God of the supernatural. We can tap into the powers of the supernatural right here in the natural world. Why? Because God is constantly revealing Himself to us as we grow to maturity. Now, exploring this aspect of scripture, let me tell you that modern philosophy tries to deny God. And there's millions of people that rely on that experimentation. Since they never experienced God, they don't believe Him. Because they don't have a first-hand experience. They only listen to people preaching on TV, or a friend, a crazy friend, that comes and preaches the gospel, and they think they're all crazy and lunatics, and you know, they're not of this world. And then they listen to people that they highly consider denying God, and they'll make a choice between believing in God or denying God. So they'll say God is expired, and the idea of God is expired, and it's over. Now the question is, how can we find God? I know I found Him. Many of you, most of you here in this church will say, I found God, I found Jesus. I found Jesus 30 years ago. I found Jesus last year. I found Jesus last month. So how can we find Jesus? Now, Scripture tells us in that we need to receive Him. And what does this mean to receive Him? In the Gospel of John, chapter 1 and verse 10, Scripture says about Jesus, He was in the world, and the world was made through Him, yet the world did not know Him. He came to His own, and His own people did not receive Him. But to all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. So, this summarizes the process of getting to know God or finding God. Scripture says that He was already in the world, but people could not recognize that He was in the world. He was born among the Jewish people that were trained for centuries to worship the true God, and they didn't recognize Him either. So they did not receive Him. But to all who received and believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. And that's who we are. That's why we call each other brother and sister. It's because in the Lord, that's who we are. We are God's children. Spiritually, we have brothers, sisters. We have a multitude of people in this world that belong to the same family. Who are they? All that who receive Him. Now, I don't like to go into details of Greek and Hebrew language, but sometimes we really need to understand what does this mean, receiving. And there's the Greek word translated into English, receiving, means to receive, to associate with oneself in a familiar or intimate act or relation, to assume an office, to learn, to receive, to take. So what does it mean to receive Jesus? It means that now we associate deeply with Him, with His teachings, with what He came to do, with His mission. That's what makes us Christian. We're not Christian because we come to church. We're Christian because we receive Him. And as we receive God, He will gently start to reveal Himself to us as we go through life. First, you will receive Jesus, and many of us have this experience the first years with Jesus. We had so many miracles happening in our life, and so many good things happening in our life, and then suddenly things change. We went through stages in which it seems that God is now distant, that He suddenly forgot about us. So we go through different stages until we reach maturity. And when we reach maturity, then God will reveal Himself in a mature way, in an adult way. And this happens in a certain stage of our spiritual growth. This is why we have, the ISOM school. We do all sorts of activities to promote spiritual growth. Because we don't want people to be ignorant of who God is. We don't want people to depend on the pastor to receive a word from God. You can receive the word from God yourself. You're not depending on the pastor or on the bishop or someone to bring God's word. You can receive the word of God yourself. However, you need to be mature. And certain Christians are deceived because they think they're receiving words from God, when in fact they're receiving words from their own conscience. They're receiving words from other sources, which are not God's. It's not the source that was intended at first. So we come to church. And in church, we try to align whatever we receive from God, and we have pastors that will help us to make this experience with God a reality, so we go through life doing God's will. Now, to receive Jesus, as I told you, doesn't mean that you have to join this church or to embrace a particular doctrine. And I would like to give you two simple things, two simple things we need to do in our lives in order to receive this revelation from God constantly and in a daily basis. And the first thing I want to tell you is that if you want truly to receive revelation from God and know that God is real, that he's not expired, that he's constantly in your life, just reject living in anger. And this is a great problem in our days. Anger is an attitude we allow to surface in our lives, from not getting something we want, and more important, from not getting something we think we deserve. That's what anger is all about. Anger is the emotion that we experience when we feel that somebody owes us something. And listen, we live in Canada, and the mentality we have, we want it all, and we want it now. Some of you even know the song, "We Want It All," you know, "We Want It Now." People think they deserve a lot of things. They think they deserve that the government takes care of them. They think they deserve a lot of things in life. It's like someone comes to you and tells you, "Oh, you know what, you deserve a break today." And you'll say, "I'll accept that, I deserve a break." And then you ask for a break, your boss doesn't give you a break or a day off, and you get angry because you feel that something is owed to you. You deserve the break and you don't have that break. A break is owed to you, and anger is initiated when we don't get the things we deserve, or more important, the things we think we deserve. Now, you get this job and you get a position, and you see suddenly that people are being promoted, and you become angry because you were not promoted. You think they owe you a promotion, and you've worked so hard, the promotion doesn't come, and now anger starts to rise up. And anger is a part of life. We will all feel angry. Some of you went through hard situations. You went through divorce, and you finally divorced because your husband was cheating on you. You felt violated because he stole from your life the best years of your life. You feel like something was stolen from you. You were betrayed. You feel really angry. And most people who walk through life with anger, also because they grew in a home in which the father left or the mother left. So they feel that their father or mother, they owe them something, because something was stolen. They didn't have that father right there. They didn't have that mother. So there's this feeling of something that was stolen. And anger, being angry is something normal. And we feel angry when we feel that something is owed. In church, there's also angry people, because they think they deserve a position in church, or they deserve attention. They feel they're very important, so they need to be publicly noted and praised. And if they lose positions of authority, they become very angry with the church, with the pastors, because they feel something was stolen, and they have this feeling inside, they owe me this, they owe me that. So you see, it's in every realm of life and activity in life, we have opportunities to be angry, because we feel something owes us, or somebody owes us something. Now in Matthew chapter 6, and we know that this prayer, the disciples were eager to learn how to have deeper fellowship with God. And this prayer is about our fellowship with the Creator of all things. So they're asking Jesus how to pray, and Jesus told them, Matthew 6, 9, pray like this: "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." I want us to focus on this verse 12. Forgive us of our debts. You see, when you think someone owes you something, you're angry. And we have a lot of angry people. I even had some of you coming to me saying, "Pastor, there's a lot of angry people in the church." Really? They need Jesus. They need to practice the Word of God. If you're angry, there's something wrong. You're not praying. Because if you're praying, you come to this part, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive the ones that owe us," and you release that forgiveness. That's easy. This is the easiest way. You know, do you want to get rid of an angry attitude? The best angry management classes are right here. Right here. Psychologists, psychiatrists cannot heal you from anger, but God can. You can take all pills that you want to numb you, to put you in another world, to do all sorts of things. But deep inside, the root of bitterness will be consuming all the soil of your heart. But when you decide to do God's will, if you want to receive Christ, it's not about doing the prayer and follow the four spiritual laws that you found in a tract. If you want to receive Christ, follow Him. Do the things that He says in His Word. And the most basic thing we need to do, if you want fellowship with God, if you want maturity and receive revelation, if you don't want an expired God in your life, then you need to give this simple step. Forgive those who owe you. And most important, forgive those you think they owe you. Because sometimes our mind can deceive us. And we see things that are not there. And we live in realities that are not of this world. Many times there's influences of demonic spirits, demonic activity. Because when you're angry, you will not receive anything you pray for. You pray and your prayers are not answered. You may be angry with your wife because you think you deserve more kisses. Hello? And now you're angry. And suddenly you explode. You're angry with someone at work. And then you explode and you mistreat your children. This is who we are. We are made a flesh and bone, and we have a spirit, and we have a soul, and it's fragile. And the most basic thing we need to have is forgiveness. If you want to receive God's forgiveness, He's here to forgive you. But if you want to have fellowship with the God that created you and receive revelation from Him, you need to start forgiving others. If you're constantly spreading around that you're angry with this one, and you're hurt with that one, and you're hurt with that one, and you feel that someone stole you something, or that if you have this position, you don't have it anymore, grow up. Just grow up. And you do it by saying, "God, forgive me. And God, I forgive this person."
Amen.
We'll be angry with people, with life, with ourselves, even with God. You know, sometimes God also gets angry. The Bible doesn't say, "You shall not get angry." It's not written in the Bible. So, you're allowed to be angry, but you're not allowed to remain there. If we walk around telling how much we hurt with someone, we're not applying the principles that we've learned from the Bible. 2 Corinthians 3:6, the Bible says about Jesus, who has made us competent to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. You know what this means? It means that you may know the letter of the Bible, you may know the Bible by heart, and be dead. Why? Because it's not the Bible who saves you. You're not saved. You don't receive Jesus by having a knowledge of the Bible. You receive Him in the Spirit. In the Spirit. And when you walk in the Spirit, then there's things that happen. Suddenly you're able to forgive. When you walk in the Spirit, God will put a red light when you have a bad thought. God will tell walk in the spirit, you'll do it. If you walk in the flesh or just by the letter, you know the Bible. You can quote scripture. But you know what? Even the devil quotes scripture. The devil quotes scripture. He quoted scripture even to Jesus. He was quoting scripture. The letter kills, but the spirit gives life. Gives life. There are people that speak of the spirit, but they don't live in the spirit. They talk about prayer, but they don't pray. They talk about miracles, but they don't have those miracles present in their life. And this reveals a nature of a person that is lost in church. That is lost going to a religion or religious meetings. You can be lost. And then there's angry, and there's angry behavior, and there's bitterness, and all sorts of bad things. One of the worst things that can happen to a person is when they become an angry Christian. And they start to talk bad about other people, and pastors, and churches, and ministers, and they criticize this one and that one, and they know all the bad news about what's happening in churches. That's horrible. It's repulsive. And this is one of the reasons why in this world we have a lot of people that don't come to church. It's because they don't want to be in an environment, in an atmosphere where they sit beside a lot of angry people, where they are told, you can't do this, you cannot do that, you can't wear this shirt, you cannot wear this shirt, and this haircut, and not that haircut, and you can't do this, you cannot do that. That's horrible. Living in Christ is freedom. Freedom to live that life that God intended for us. And it all starts with forgiveness. Wow, this is silent. Second thing and last thing, I have a message with 2 points. They're a bit long, but I want to give you everything the Lord put in my heart for this morning. Don't be angry. Second thing, learn how to be grateful. And we're celebrating Thanksgiving, and I'd like to read this scripture in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. It says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. We read this scripture last week, and I'd like to read it again. Because if you want to truly have a relationship with God, you need to be grateful. How can we be grateful? You know, Christians need to meditate. You know, this issue of meditation, why are we allowing yoga and all these oriental religions to tell us what meditate means? Meditate means simply this. You meditate when you're thinking in what is good, what is pure, what all the things that are in this list of Philippians. When you do these things, you're meditating. Now let me give you the opposite. If you're worried about paying your bills, and you start meditating on paying your bills, what is the result? You worry. You worry. And then you start being fearful. And when you're afraid, your faith doesn't work. So if you set your mind to think about negative things, guess what happens in your life? We're having this board meeting yesterday. We had an excellent board meeting on Friday. And we were talking about the good things the Lord is doing in our church. We had 60 kids in Kids in the Park. And we were watching, you know, that giant banana split. Wasn't that awesome? And we were talking about our Bible school. We have almost 40 students doing a 2-year Bible school in the local church. Isn't that fantastic? And we were talking about share and about the outreach ministry that is so full. We don't know where to put more people. We have 70 to 80 people. And we're talking about all these good things. And someone was telling me that we have a lot of angry people and upset people because they see a lot of things in the church they don't like. I'm stepping on your toes on purpose. Because you need to listen to this. Think about the good things the Lord is doing. Do not do it. Think about these things. Why am I telling you this? You think I'm worried if people talk bad things about the church or the pastor or whatever? I'm not worried for myself. I'm worried for you. I'm worried for you. Because whenever you spend your time thinking about all the bad things and all the problems you see around you, you're being denied of receiving revelation from God. Eventually, you get to a point in which God is expired in your life. Reach the expiration date. And you don't want to get to that point. That's why Paul said, whatever you learn and receive and heard and see in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. By other words, you want to receive God, you want to be associated with God, spend your time meditating in these things that are pure, honest, have good faith, all of these things. And so, the maker of the world, he's right here, and he's in your life, to help you to receive the best things he has prepared for you. Number one, don't be angry. Number two, be grateful. And if you practice these things, your whole life is going to change. Again, the verse that we read for this morning, as we conclude, John chapter 1, verses 10 to 12. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. This is God's house. You have a father. My father and my mother used to correct me when I was a kid. Later in life, they corrected me in a different way, but they still try to correct me. When we're in church, we can expect to receive also correction. Not in a harsh way. Church is a place of freedom. But I want to tell you this in Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is an attitude. It's not a holiday in October. To me, Thanksgiving is every day. Is it for you? Or you think Thanksgiving is about having a party and stuff yourself with turkey and stuffing and cranberry and all that. And then you say, whoa, this is Thanksgiving. Where's the pie? You know, Thanksgiving, it's awesome. It's an attitude. Why do we celebrate it once a year? Because our forefathers, the people that arrived to Canada to establish a new world, they came here because they were sick of the old world, and they said, we're going to build a society with God. Yeah. That's why they came. That's why they came. They didn't come to bring Coca-Cola and Heinz ketchup and all this stuff we have around. They came here because they said, there's a new hope, there's a new land, and we're going to build churches. And in this region, they build a lot of churches. But they didn't build the church. They had buildings that now are empty. They had cities with names of saints and all sorts of Christian mythology. I use the word carefully, mythology. Because some of those saints and all these people just started. But they forgot the most important thing, to build the people. Now we have the opportunity, 21st century, to build the real church out of the ashes of the old establishment in our area. And we do it by introducing Jesus Christ to others around us. How can we introduce someone that we don't know? I've been in offices of people, and sometimes they have these pictures on the wall. I remember being in an office of a person with a picture of an American president. They said, wow, you have a picture with the president of the United States. That's really something. They said, oh, yeah. I was in this place, and they took out our picture. And I asked, did you get to know him? Oh, no, never. You see, we can have the picture of Jesus. And we can, you know, smile. You know? I can bring the mayor, the city here, or, you know, Stephen Harper, or whoever, and you shake hands and you smile for the picture and you show your kids. But you've never truly met that person as Christians. If you don't want to have an expired God, and if you want people around us to know that God isn't expired, we need to manifest God's presence.
Yes.
How do we do it? We need to have a relationship with Him. And as we develop that relationship, we cannot let it escape through our fingers. But many Christians do, because they become angry, they're bitter, they don't have patience with anyone, they have outbursts of anger, they don't know truly how to express their love. And it's time today to say, I'm going to change that. I don't want anyone to leave this place offended. But let me tell you, this message was for you. Just for you. You didn't come here to listen just to a man, because you could turn on your TV and you have better preaching on TV probably than what you have here. But we don't come here to church because of the quality of the message and how it's built. We come here to listen to what God has for us today.
Amen.
And today God has something very simple for you. Two simple things. Reject being angry. And number two, be grateful. Let us all stand. Thank you very much for the Lord. Praise God. As always, we like to finish our services with an altar call. And we like to pray for people. And we ask you not to leave the church for the next, you know, 5-10 minutes. Even if you're not receiving prayer, just worship the Lord with our worship team. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11, finally, brothers, rejoice. Tell the person next to you, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And if you do these things, the God of love and peace will be with you.
Amen.
He is Emmanuel. He's God with us. But let me make this very, very clear. You may have received Jesus Christ 20 years ago. If you don't live by His rules, the Holy Spirit has already left. But God is a loving Father, and He's waiting for you. He wants to embrace you. Maybe you came here for the first, second time, and you want to receive this peace. You want to receive this joy that I'm talking about, and you can receive it right now, today, by doing a simple prayer of repentance and telling God, He's here in this place, that you repent from your old ways of life, and you want to receive Him in your life. You want to associate, not with the church, not with this particular church, but to associate with Jesus Christ. To associate with the Lord. To associate with our Savior. The one that came to the world. People still in the world cannot see Him, cannot recognize Him. They say He's expired. They say God doesn't exist. They say science is a big thing and God is against science. Let me tell you, God created science. God is the greatest scientist that you can ever know. He created all the laws, the law of gravity. He created the law of aerodynamics. He created all the laws. And He's right here. The great God, the great Creator, He honors us with His presence. And if you do just this simple prayer and ask for forgiveness, if you do that prayer that we read today, forgive my debt as I forgive all of those that owe me, then you have something happening today in your life, which is called salvation.